Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mr. Met, How a Sports Mad Kid from Jersey Became Like Family to Generations of Big Leaguers, by Jay Horwitz, narrated by Barry Abrams. Forward. I basically grew up in the middle of nowhere, a town called De Leon Springs, Florida, 30 miles inland from Daytona Beach. Not to say we were isolated, but put it this way. If any tourists ever came through De Leon Springs, they were probably lost. Coming up as a young kid in baseball throughout the minor leagues, you never really did interviews and whatnot. You didn't have to deal with any of that media stuff. So it was a big transition going from that background to making my major league debut with the New York Mets in the biggest media market there is. I was lucky to have Jay Horwitz there for me during that adjustment period and for years to come. I remember my first day with the team was during the May 2014 Subway Series. I'd been called up from AAA Las Vegas on May 13th to join the team. Here I was, a kid from De Leon, showing up at Yankee Stadium, just trying to take it all in, not really sure what was going on. I was going to pitch out of the bullpen, but then word came that instead, 2 days later, I was going to start a game against the New York Yankees, which that year meant Derek Jeter, Mark Teixeira, and Alfonso Soriano. It's funny what you remember about a day like that. My first day pitching in the big leagues was at Citi Field, a great crowd of more than 40,000. I got a hit and finished the day with a 1,000 batting average. I held the Yankees scoreless through the first 6 innings, but lost 1-0. Of course, I was frustrated we didn't win. I'd have loved to win my major league debut, but more than anything, I was excited about being in the big leagues. Before I talked to the reporters, a guy came over to my locker to tell me what to keep in mind when I talked to the media. That was Jay, there to help. I remember thinking it felt kind of weird, like, who is this guy telling me how I'm supposed to do this interview? It didn't take me long to realize how valuable an asset Jay was to me and to every Mets player. His advice was simple and good. If you're honest with the media and you give them the time, they'll respect you. That was big for me first coming up, and still today. Just take accountability. Whether you had a good start or a bad start, be there at your locker afterward, ready to talk to the media about what happened, because that's what they want to hear. Just tell them how things went and what you saw out there. That advice has helped me out a tremendous amount throughout my career. I don't want to sugarcoat any of this, I told Jay that first season. That's good, he said. So I didn't sugarcoat. If I went out there and stunk, I talked about that with the media. If I had a good day, I talked about that. Jay and me didn't always see eye to eye. There were times when we butted heads, and then the next day it was like, hey, Jay, sorry about that. Love you, man. He was completely fine with it. He never held a grudge. Whether you were having a bad day with him or a good day with him, every day was a new day with Jay. He was always rooting for you, and that was why everybody in the locker room loved him. He truly cared about the players and truly wanted the best for them. It was never about Jay. It was always about the players and about the team. He was truly a Mets fan. He wanted this team to win, and he wanted the players to perform, and you knew that. It was great having a guy like that around. Knowing that he was on your side was always a huge plus. One thing I noticed early on was that any time a great Mets player from recent years showed up, he would see Jay and break into a smile, and they'd immediately start talking like old friends. They trusted him, and the way they trusted him showed me Jay always had the players' interests in mind. That was true for teammates of mine like David Wright, and it was true for the stars of the 1980s and 1990s Mets, guys like Dwight Gooden, Darryl Strawberry, and John Franco. All those guys loved Jay. You could tell he was one of the guys. He had their best interests at heart, and knowing that made you feel comfortable with anything you were going to say to Jay, knowing he was trying to protect you. By the time I came along, we didn't play jokes on Jay quite the way so many of the older guys did, like David Wright and John Franco, who loved to mess with Jay a little. We just horsed around with him. He'd come through the locker room, and we'd joke around with him, If we were shooting baskets at this little basketball hoop we had set up in there, we'd try to get him to take part. "Hey, Jay, try to make a shot," we'd all call out. Every once in a while, he'd make one. It was all in good fun, and everybody would be all excited when he made one. One day, I was doing soft toss with him with a big ball, trying to get him to hit it in the locker room. It cracks me up thinking about it even now. I'm grateful I got to spend time with him. Jay always cared so much about every game. He didn't like losing. If I lost a game, sometimes it was almost as if it was Jay who had made that start. He took it so hard. He'd say something like, "Oh, man." He felt really bad for you, but you came in the next day, and it was a new day. When you think about Jay Horwitz and how much he cares about this organization, how he's spent 40 years with this organization, how it's like the Mets players and Mets organization are a part of his family, I really do think Jay is Mr. Met. His heart is with the players and this team. That is what Jay had, and he loved it. That showed in how he loved the players. We were his family. I still feel that way about him. I love when he comes around. Still today, after starts, whether it's good or bad, I'll get a text from Jay, and I read that, and it puts a smile on my face. This guy, he's still pulling for me, even though his role has changed to a job in alumni relations. I truly do miss having him around in the clubhouse. I'm glad I'll have this book to read for years to remind me of Jay and how much he loves the Mets and how much he loves baseball. Jacob deGrom. Introduction. It's been an amazing run. I've spent a good part of my adult life living out my childhood dream, going back to the days when my dad and I tossed a ball back and forth in our backyard in Clifton, New Jersey. I've had the amazing fortune to work for the New York Mets since 1980. I've formed deep friendships with many of the greatest ballplayers of recent decades, and I've been there to watch baseball history unfold up close, time and time again. It's all I could have ever asked out of life, and I know how lucky I am to have had such great experiences and such great friends in the game. The world of professional sports has changed a lot since I first started with the Mets, but nothing can change or diminish the power of great moments in sports to bring us together and to tell us more about who we are. I never thought I'd write a book. The idea came up all the time whenever I launched into another funny or revealing story and people suggested I tell my stories, but a book never felt like me. I'm a private guy. I like disappearing into the work of media relations director. That's maybe one reason I've gladly given so much to the job day after day, almost never taking a sick day through four decades, and keeping the players laughing. Tyler Kepner once wrote in the New York Times that I have the smallest ego in baseball, and maybe that's right. I never loved making it about me. It was about the players. It was about the stories. It was about the game. Then, in September 2018, the Mets decided it was time to move me to a new role. After 38 seasons as the head of PR for the team, most recently as Vice President of Media Relations, I would be moving on to the post of Vice President of Alumni Relations and Mets Club Historian. It was an adjustment. I'd no longer be traveling with the team, and I wouldn't see as much of the players. But you close one door, and another one opens. I found I loved the work of reaching out to former Mets players, many of whom I already know well. Thinking about the franchise I love from the perspective of Mets club historian, it hit home for me how much Mets history I've personally lived through. It dawned on me that readers might be entertained if I set down some of the oddball experiences I've had over the years, from spilling orange juice on Mets general manager Frank Cashin during my job interview to join the organization, spoiler alert, I got the job, to making a wrong turn and getting lost on my drive to Shea Stadium for my first day on the job. I ended up in Brooklyn. It occurred to me that my stories might help cast a fresh light on four exciting decades of Mets baseball. The way I see it, I've never had a job in my life. Not really. I've just accepted paychecks for doing what I love and would do for nothing. I'd been drawn to offbeat human interest stories even before I started with the Mets. I landed the Mets job because in my previous PR work at Fairleigh Dickinson University, I'd shown a certain flair for pitching colorful stories to try to scrape and claw our way to a little coverage. As an Associated Press article in 1979 put it, FDU's popular sports publicist Jay Horwitz has built a reputation for coming up with bizarre stories. My reputation at Fairleigh Dickinson led to NBC's Game of the Week hiring me earlier in 1980 to work on its production staff. Then, the Mets offer came along. With the Mets, I can be more me than I could be with NBC, I said at the time. The Mets were not a good team back then. They finished the 1980 season 67-95, and they wanted me to be resourceful in finding fresh angles to get people interested in the players and the team. As Vinny Detrani wrote in the Hackensack Record when I was hired in March 1980, Jay Horwitz may be facing the toughest challenge of his career. It was one thing to get Fairleigh Dickinson University national exposure in magazines such as Sports Illustrated and on network television, but it's another to get the New York Mets some positive publicity. Bada bada bing. I found that the lessons I learned getting to know the players on a bad team to try to drum up coverage helped me a lot when it came time to working with great teams that everybody wanted to hear about. The key was always to pay attention, to keep your eyes open at all times, and to keep in mind the ultimate reason you're there, to help the players. Sometimes you had to be tough to help a player. More often, what it took was consideration. Jay spoke kindly, never raised his voice, Kevin Mitchell, a rookie on the World Series-winning 1986 Mets team, said recently. He always was the kind of guy that came to me and talked in a quiet tone of voice that settled me down. Darryl Strawberry, another friend from those years, says now, Jay did a great job of keeping us all focused and keeping us together. We had a crazy bunch, and we'd go through some headlines. There was always something that I tried to overcome. Jay smoothed things out and kept the writers off of me. He was always there to put the fire out. Jay was always there to walk me through things. I was always the butt of jokes, and the players loved that I could laugh at myself. It helped bring us together, but I also had a job to do. One time in the 80s, my dad and I were in the old elevator at Shea with Jay, and someone was giving him a hard time, Jeff Wilpon recalls. Afterward, my father told me, "You protect that man. He's a good man, and he does a great job for the organization. You protect him." So, that's what I've always tried to do over my career. We all poke fun at one another, but I was there to protect Jay if anything was going too far afield. If that happened, I was usually in the background and able to step in. I'm writing this book for Darryl and Dwight and Mitch and John Franco and David Wright and all the players who feel like family to me, and for Jeff and Fred and Saul and all the people in the Mets organization who treated me so well. But above all, I'm writing it for four people. My parents, Milton and Gertrude, who protected me because of my eye, treated me like a king, and always gave me everything I ever wanted. No kid could ever have been treated better. And two other people outside of baseball who have always stood by me, Linda and Mark Emmer, who made me feel like part of their family, along with their daughter Christine and her husband Jimmy Coleman, and Linda's sister, Lori Romano. We lost my father to cancer in 1970, and after my mom died in 1990, Linda and Mark made sure I always had a place to come for every holiday and always knew I had them in my corner. Linda and I mourned together when Mark passed away in January 2019, and I hope some of the stories in this book will make her smile. Part 1. The Making of a Sports Nut. 1. Growing up in New Jersey. Sports were everything to me growing up. This was New Jersey in the 1950s, long before kids had all the various entertainments they take for granted now. Sports was what connected people. I was actually born on August 14, 1945 in the Bronx, not far from Yankee Stadium. The Bombers were on the road then, in the middle of a 9-game losing streak, which might have something to do with why I never ended up being a Yankee fan. That was a historic day all over the world, and not because of my birth. It was VJ Day, the day that U.S. victory over Japan in World War II was announced. The long national nightmare of years of war in Europe and Asia was finally over. Japan surrenders, end of war, was stripped across all six columns of the New York Times. The governor of New Jersey declared a two-day state holiday, and in nearby Passaic, New Jersey, a front-page headline in the Herald News read, "City's thousands go wild with joy in hysterical victory celebration." In one magic minute following the radio announcement, the city was yanked out of its normal calm to become an hysterically happy, bedlam-raising community, reporter Edward J. Reardon wrote. Pedestrians staged their own parade through the main streets. Women and children were in the cavalcade that marched, Indian file, beating on pots and pans, tooting on colored horns, or adding to the racket with cowbells and other noise-making gadgets, leftovers from some long-forgotten Halloween or New Year's Eve party. My mother Gertrude did not take part in the cavalcade. She was busy giving birth to me. She'd come down with a case of German measles when she was pregnant with me, and soon after I was born I was diagnosed with glaucoma in my right eye, which had a blue film over it. I was blind in that eye, something I've never made public before. My left eye was green, and that was my one good eye. Having different colored eyes, I always identified with pitcher Max Scherzer, who had one blue eye and one green eye when he was a baby, but his green eye eventually turned brown. I had a hard time as a child. I wasn't like the other kids in grammar school, and they made sure I never forgot I was different. I was subjected to constant staring and ribbing. Not a day went by without another kid at school making fun of me for having different colored eyes. I can't even count the number of times I went home from school crying. That was a regular occurrence. I dreaded school. Any social situation left me feeling really uncomfortable because I didn't want kids making fun of me and knew they probably would anyway. Then, when I was in sixth grade, the doctors recommended my right eye be removed. That was the only way to contain the risk of glaucoma spreading to my left eye, which would have left me totally blind. My parents agreed. I went to Columbia Presbyterian Hospital, and Dr. Ira Jones performed the surgery, removing my eye. He was not only a skilled surgeon, but a warm, generous man who became a good friend to me and was always there to console me in future years. After the surgery, I was out of school for 2 months. I was very fortunate that my sixth-grade teacher, Joyce Esslinger, was a remarkable woman. I had a big crush on her. She was young and devoted to her students, a recent education graduate of Patterson State College who also did graduate work at Seton Hall. During those 2 months I was out of school, I could easily have fallen way behind, but Miss Esslinger took it upon herself to visit me at home regularly to pep me up. That made a huge difference for me, and I'll never forget her incredible generosity in making that commitment to me. I wasn't much of a student, but she saw some promise in me and urged me to do something with my life. Her words of encouragement always stayed with me. I came back to school after my 2 month absence and still was the constant butt of jokes. I'd been fitted with an artificial eye, but it was still obvious something wasn't right about my eyes. The taunting and ridicule still hurt, but not quite as much as before, and over time, I grew to accept the teasing as a part of growing up. I was never part of the in crowd, not by a long stretch, but I was popular enough at junior high school that my fellow students voted me class giggler. Being born with one eye made me a better person, I think. Being born with a disability and having to work to overcome it gave me a different perspective on life and on other people. I've always tended to gravitate more to people who are disabled or otherwise feel singled out for kidding or mockery. I think that what I went through as a kid made me all the more determined to help people whenever I could, and that remains true to this day. Just because you're born with a disability doesn't mean you can't get ahead in life. I didn't have a rich father. I didn't have any special advantages. But with some hard work and a lot of luck, I've been able to have an amazing career. I've always been a little awkward, clumsy, accident-prone, a little bit of a schlump, as I've put it before. As a kid, I always felt like an outsider looking in, never one of the guys until I found some way to bridge the gap. Sports was my way to connect with others. Sports brought my dad and me closer together, and sports helped me make friends. If I was more sports mad than any of them, I'd have friends, and with a dad like mine, I could talk sports with the best of them. I got my passion for sports from my dad, the son of Russian Jewish immigrants who worked hard and ended up running a factory that produced coats for girls. My mother worked as a bookkeeper. My dad and I were always talking sports at home. We loved reading the paper every morning because that was how we kept up on the football New York Giants and the New York Knicks and the baseball New York Giants. Starting in the 1958 season, my dad would get us season tickets to see all the football Giants home games. And I'll never forget sitting there with my dad watching former first-round pick Frank Gifford running the ball, and on defense, Rosie Grier and Andy Robustelli. We were fanatical about every detail of the team. When the Giants traded Dick Nolan, Bobby Joe Conrad, and a first-round pick to the Chicago Cardinals for Pat Summerall and Lyndon Crow, it was big news to us. Summerall was the star of one of the big games of the 1958 season, kicking a 49-yard field goal on the final play of the game to beat the Detroit Lions on December 14th. That led to an NFL championship game against the Baltimore Colts none of us would ever forget on December 28th before a roaring crowd of 64,185 at Yankee Stadium. That was a thrilling game, the first NFL playoff game to go into sudden-death overtime, later known as the greatest game ever played. I certainly thought so as a 13-year-old, and so did all of New York, even though our Giants lost to the Colts. As Gene Ward wrote in the New York Daily News, "In the years to come, when our children's children are listening to stories about football, they'll be told about the greatest game ever played, the one between the Giants and Colts for the 1958 NFL Championship. They'll be told of heroics the like of which never had been seen, of New York's slashing two-touchdown rally to a 17-14 lead, of Baltimore's not-tying field goal 7 seconds from the end of regulation playing time, and finally, of the bitter collapse of the magnificent Giant defense as the Colts slammed and slung their way to a 23-17 triumph with an 80-yard touchdown drive in the first sudden-death period ever played." One of my favorites was quarterback Y.A. Tittle, who led the Giants to 3 straight NFL championship games in the early 1960s after the San Francisco 49ers gave up on him, thinking he was too old and too slow to get the job done. I could always relate to the athlete with something to prove, and that was Y.A. Tittle. As the New York Times later wrote, "Tittle threw for dozens of touchdowns and thousands of yards, won a Most Valuable Player award, and was selected to 7 Pro Bowls. But he endeared himself to New York not as a golden boy, but as a muddied, grass-stained scrapper." Y.A. put it this way, "I've been old and bald-headed and ugly since I've been 28. Frank Gifford later wrote in his book, The Whole 10 Yards, "For all Y.A.'s bumpkin ways, I suspect the city saw in him a reflection of itself." I know I sure did. My dad and I didn't just watch sports, we also played sports together. At home, my dad and I would toss the ball back and forth in the backyard every day during the summer. I knew I was never going to play baseball like Willie Mays or Jackie Robinson, but my dad worked with me and encouraged me and helped give me the confidence to go out and play ball. He pushed me to play Little League, and I'm glad I gave it a try. I played second base for a team sponsored by Epstein's Department Store in Clifton. My mom went along. She used to go to Little League games with me, but when I was small, my dad was the driving force. Gradually over time, my mother became a sports nut because of me, and in later years, she and I went to many New York Giants football games together. I wasn't much of a second baseman, but I was better in the field than up to bat. I was afraid to swing away and always bunted, hoping the pitcher would walk me. As Jack DeVries later wrote in a piece for Clifton Merchant Magazine, describing my Little League days for an article looking back at our Clifton High School graduating class, when it came his turn to bat, he would tuck his small body into a crouch and bunt, every time. It didn't matter if there were runners on base or not, how many outs there were in an inning, Horwitz would square and face the pitcher. My mom and dad got so frustrated with me, my dad said if I didn't go up there swinging, he wasn't going to let me play Little League anymore. I got the message. At our next game at Clifton's Main Memorial Park, against one of the best teams in the league, Jacques Wolfe, I went up there determined to swing and closed my eyes and took a big cut. To my surprise, I hit a bullet to center field that bounced once before the outfielder could get to it. I was so shocked I'd hit the ball, I was momentarily stunned. Then, when I did start running, I tripped coming out of the batter's box. The center fielder, Rich Less, threw me out at first base. I left the game crying, and my dad took me home. I think that was the only time I ever hit the ball. I was an uncoordinated kid, but at least I did hit it that one time. That was the end of my Little League career. I played basketball now and then at the Jewish Community Center, but playing sports wasn't my thing. Watching sports was my thing. When my dad and I went to the Polo Grounds to see the Giants, that was all we talked about that day. We both loved Willie Mays, who grew up in Alabama and started playing for the Birmingham Black Barons of the Negro Leagues from a young age. Mays made his big league debut with the Giants in 1951, then was in the Army and rejoined the Giants for the 1954 season. He batted .345 with 41 home runs that year and ran the bases and roamed the field with as much speed and explosiveness as any ball player I've ever seen. I'll never forget watching the 1954 World Series against the Cleveland Indians at home with my dad. When Willie Mays made the catch against Vic Wertz running backward deep in center field during the eighth inning of Game 1, we jumped into each other's arms. That iconic catch with two runners on base set up an extra inning win for the Giants on Dusty Rhodes' three-run homer, just over the short right field wall at the Polo Grounds, only 258 feet from home plate, with Mays scoring the winning run. The Giants went on to sweep the series, even though the Indians came into the series heavily favored. We felt like we were in baseball heaven. There were any number of Giant heroes in the World Series, but the fellow whose name was on everyone's lips was Willie Mays, columnist Arthur Daly wrote in the New York Times. He's an exciting ball player, even when he does nothing, which is rare. But when he makes a catch such as he did on Vic Wertz in the opening game, he also sold a bill of goods to millions of television viewers. After watching that with incredulous eyes, they're willing to believe anything they read or hear about this baseball Paul Bunyan. Then, when I was 13 years old, we started hearing talk about owner Horace Stoneham moving the Giants to California. This wasn't like when the Baltimore Colts of the NFL pulled out in the middle of the night in a driving snowstorm, leaving so many fans in Baltimore shocked and devastated. The Giants' move played out in slow motion. On July 18, 1957, the New York Times headline ran, "Stoneham favors Giants transfer. Club president backs move in 58 if San Francisco makes a suitable offer." Then, 5 days later came the Times headline, "Coast Mayor Leaves. San Francisco official is confident of Giants' move." Then, 4 weeks later, came the thunderclap. "Giants will shift to San Francisco for 1958 season," blared the New York Times headline on August 20, 1957. I picked up the morning papers that day and saw the news and started to cry. When I saw my dad, I was hoping he'd tell me it was all some cruel hoax. But no, he confirmed the awful truth. We'd lost the Giants. I was inconsolable. I thought I would never see Willie Mays again. My mom and dad promised they'd take me to Philadelphia so we could still see the Giants play the Phillies, and we did that every single year until the arrival of the New York Mets in 1962. To this day, I live in the small house in Clifton, New Jersey, where I grew up. I've lived other places, but I kept coming back. My parents moved us into the house on Grant Street in December 1954. an event that actually made the local paper. In New Home was the headline on a short article in the December 7, 1954 Paterson News. Mr. and Mrs. Milton Horwitz moved into their new home this month, the article read. Formerly from New York, the Horwitzes are in Clifton a short time. They have a son, Jay. Even at age 9, I thought it was pretty cool to see our names in the paper. I'd show up in the paper now and then as a kid, like in April 1956 for assisting our cantor Bernard Matlin at the Clifton Jewish Center, or 2 years later when I presented the traditional Bible gift at the June 1958 bar mitzvah of my friend Richard Sachs at the center. My own bar mitzvah was in September 1958. The traditional Bible gift came from my friend Michael Feltman, and Rabbi Eugene Markovitz oversaw the occasion. Rabbi was very good to me, very patient. I was never good at memorizing texts, and I was having a hard time trying to learn my Torah reading for the bar mitzvah. He helped me get through it all right, as he later helped me get through my mother's funeral and Game 6 of the 1986 World Series. I couldn't play sports at Clifton High School. I was so small, 5'1" and maybe 90 pounds, my parents wanted to take me to a doctor. But what was that going to do? I was also awkward. Other kids loved Fred Lombardo's woodshop class. I dreaded every day there. Every wooden bowl I tried to make ended up with a hole in the bottom. One of my favorite teachers was my English teacher, Peter Lowray. Jay was a character, one of my favorites, Lowray later told the Clifton Merchant Magazine. Once in class, we were talking about the word vicissitude, meaning change. When I asked for someone to use it in a sentence, Jay raised his hand and said, "All women go through vicissitudes." We all broke up laughing. Good to hear I could at least make people laugh. I wasn't a social person in high school. I was socially backward. Not that it was an unhappy time, but I wasn't part of the in crowd. Since I couldn't play sports, I did the next best thing. I became varsity manager for every team I could, cross country, basketball, and baseball. I lettered in more sports than the best athlete at the school. At our senior awards ceremony, my letterman sweater had 8 stripes, which was more than the starting quarterback had. I'll never forget the cheerleaders all looking at me and talking about me. "Who is that?" one of them said, suddenly very interested. I graduated in June 1963, and that was a summer of hope and optimism. Our class motto was, "The old order changeth, yielding place to new." Fittingly enough, 2.5 years into the presidency of young, dynamic John F. Kennedy. I was obsessed with the Kennedy administration. I was a liberal Democrat who loved politics even more than sports at the time and thought I might want to be a presidential press secretary, like Pierre Salinger, Kennedy's White House press secretary. The June I graduated, Kennedy was in Europe, meeting with leaders like West German Chancellor Konrad Adenauer. On June 26th, he visited the divided city of Berlin, where the East German regime had shocked the world starting in August 1961, by building a wall topped with barbed wire to keep its own citizens from leaving. That was the trip when Kennedy made his famous "Ich bin ein Berliner" speech in front of hundreds of thousands of people gathered in the West Berlin neighborhood of Schönberg. 2,000 years ago, the proudest boast was "Civis Romanus sum," Kennedy said, referring to citizens of Rome. Today, in the world of freedom, the proudest boast is "Ich bin ein Berliner." All free men, wherever they may live, are citizens of Berlin, and therefore, as a free man, I take pride in the words, "Ich bin ein Berliner." I should have never gotten into New York University. I didn't have the grades. To be blunt, I'm not really sure I even had the brains, not at this point. But I did have Uncle Murray. My mother's brother, Murray Burkow, who started at Republic Aviation Corporation as a research engineer in 1941 and worked his way up to vice president, was on the NYU board of directors. Uncle Murray played a big role in getting me accepted to NYU, and without him, I don't think I'd ever had a shot. I went to NYU to study journalism, since I wanted to get into politics or work in sports. I chose NYU because I liked their basketball program. They played their home games at Madison Square Garden, and every game was sold out. That was in that golden period when New York City teams were helping launch college basketball to a new level of popularity. In 1960, the NYU Violets, under coach Lou Rossini, were one of the top basketball teams in the country and made it all the way to the NCAA Final Four, held that year in the Cow Palace, just south of San Francisco. That was the year Ohio State beat California in the final. Cincinnati, led by Oscar Robertson, won the third-place game, so NYU had to settle for fourth place. When I enrolled at NYU in fall 1963, I immediately applied to be manager of the basketball team. Given my background in high school as manager of so many teams, I figured I had a good shot, and I was right. Coach Rossini took me on and became like a second father to me. I loved getting to know the players, guys like Barry Kramer, who had played on the same high school team, Linton High in Schenectady, New York, as another future NBA player, Pat Riley. I came into Madison Square Garden a lot when I was in high school to watch games, and I'd been a great admirer of Barry Kramer for years. I loved how he played. He and Art Heyman at Duke were the two best shooters I ever saw, and they were both Jewish. When I was in high school, I wanted to get to the same school as Barry Kramer. Barry was a beautiful player who, as a junior in 1963, was on his way to an All-American season. He just missed averaging 30 points, 29.3, and was the second leading scorer in the nation. Best of all, he was a nice guy who let me talk his ear off with all my theories on sports, even though I was truly in awe of meeting him the first time. He used to come into my room at night and talk about the games with me and some of the other fellows, Barry remembers now. I'm amazed he remembers me. That was a long time ago. Barry went on to a remarkable career, chosen by the San Francisco Warriors 6th overall in the 1964 NBA Draft, seeing action with the Warriors, the New York Knicks, and the New York Nets, then going to law school, practicing law for more than 20 years, and finally winning election in 2009 to the New York State Supreme Court. His recollections of our time together at NYU in the 1960s are a little foggy at this point, he says, but this part he'll never forget. He was a strongly opinionated guy, as I recall, he says now with a chuckle. That's my recollection. He was definitely a sports guy whose opinions people were interested in. Mal Graham also played on those NYU teams when I was manager. He was a guard out of White Plains, New York, who, like Barry, was a first-round NBA pick and went on to serve as a high-profile judge. The Boston Celtics chose Mal with the 11th overall pick of the 1967 draft, and he was on the Celtics' championship-winning teams of 68 and 69. Health issues cut short his career, so he pursued a career in law, and last I checked, he was serving on the Massachusetts Appeals Court. I went to NYU for two reasons, the basketball team and the journalism department. Another mentor at NYU was my journalism teacher, Woody Klein, who worked as press secretary for John Lindsay when he was mayor of New York. Woody was very kind to me. He taught me sentence structure, who, when, what, why, where. He taught me the basics and helped me begin to develop my own style. I used to have to commute by train, and I remember on November 22, 1963, I was on the 7 subway line going to NYU basketball practice when I heard the terrible news that John F. Kennedy had been shot in Dallas, Texas. For a Kennedy liberal like me, as for so much of the country, the assassination of Jack Kennedy was devastating. Growing up, my passions were the Kennedys, the football Giants, and later, the Mets. I always felt in high school that John Kennedy gave people hope through programs like the Peace Corps, the Space Program, and so much else. I was a true believer in Camelot. I was such a fan of the New York Giants football team, along with my father, I hadn't missed a home game in a good 5 years. But on the Sunday after Lee Harvey Oswald killed Kennedy, I stayed home. I was in mourning. I was in shock. I couldn't pull myself away from the TV. I was watching when Jack Ruby stepped up and shot and killed Oswald. It felt like the world was falling apart. 2. A young, up-and-coming sports writer. One thing I've never talked about much with the many sports writers I've worked with over the years is my short-lived career as one of them. I've loved doing what I do so much over the years as a PR man, I wouldn't have it any other way, but I almost wound up making a career as a newspaper sports writer. I guess I'll never know if I'd have been any good if I'd pursued that direction longer than the couple of years I gave it, but I know my colleagues at the Passaic, New Jersey Herald News were very generous and gave me all kinds of great opportunities. Veteran sports writers Augie Leo and Joe Lovas were especially kind and patient. I was a very slow writer. I labored over every sentence. That was a long time ago, but I do recall them telling me over and over I had a big future in sports writing ahead of me. I don't think I ever believed them. Looking back at my clips now, they run the gamut. The first Jay Horwitz byline that shows up in a search of the Herald News archive is in August 1967 on a story from Phoenixville, Pennsylvania, about a baseball game that was rained out. One day later, I was still focused on the weather, writing, "Heavy rains soaked DeSanto Field in the bottom half of the first inning Friday night, and the Carlstadt, Woodridge, Rockville Center, New York, Middle Atlantic Regional Babe Ruth League playoff game was postponed for a second time until tonight at 8 o'clock. About the only detail worth mentioning about that story is that it ran in the Herald News over a column by the great Jim Murray, future Pulitzer Prize winner for the Los Angeles Times. I was rubbing shoulders with the best in the business, at least in print. This was more than 50 years ago, and for a lot of U.S. sports fans at the time, soccer was no more than a curiosity. For another article, I talked to a New Jersey referee who worked games in the fledgling United Soccer Association, which lasted all of one season. Not until 1970 was the North American Soccer League formed, featuring teams like the New York Cosmos, the showcase franchise of the league, with players like the Brazilian wizard Pelé, the best in the world at the time, Franz Beckenbauer of Germany, and former Harvard goalkeeper Shep Messing, whose contract was sold after he posed nude in Playgirl magazine. Will the soccer ball ever replace the traditional baseball, football, or basketball in our parks, stadiums, and arenas? I wrote on August 15, 1967. Will the new Mickey Mantle or Willie Mays be a rather slim fellow who runs around in short pants and a striped shirt? Will the World Cup ever replace the World Series? Let's explore the possibilities. Boxing was still a huge sport in the 1960s, and in August 1967, I made my first professional appearance at Shea Stadium, covering a fight. I remember sitting ringside and either blood or water got splashed all over me. I don't know what happened. I thought somebody's mouthpiece came out. It was incredible. I just remember getting splashed with something. I don't know if my writing style is for everyone, but I was having some fun with the material, that's for sure. Welterweight champion Curtis Cox is next on the list for veteran Carlos Ortiz, after the classy 30-year-old Puerto Rican successfully defended his lightweight crown for the 10th time Thursday night with a unanimous 15-round decision over Panama's Ismael Laguna at Shea Stadium, I wrote. The outcome of the fight was never in doubt. Ortiz pummeled his flashy, fast-stepping opponent with vicious lefts in the early rounds, R-O-U-N-D-apostrophe-S, sick, and devastating right uppercuts, hooks, and crosses in the later rounds to thoroughly outclass the 24-year-old challenger. "He didn't hurt me once during the fight," Ortiz said. By the next month, I was being treated as an equal with the paper's veteran scribes, listing my picks for various sporting events along with each of the other main sports writers. No one cares about high school football games from more than half a century ago, but I seemed to have some idea what I was talking about. I picked Clifton High to win a game 34-0, and yeah, okay, that was my alma mater, so I was a little overly enthusiastic, but the final score was a one-sided 21-6, and Clifton displayed a practically airtight defense, as I wrote in my game story. That was a great decade in New York sports, and I got to see a lot of the memorable athletes of that era up close. Joe Willie Namath passed the 4-mile mark in yardage in his 3-year American Football League career, and the New York Jets may be zooming toward a Super Bowl appearance this January in Miami, Florida, against the champions of the National Football League, I wrote on October 9, 1967. The Jets, who sit atop of the Eastern Division of the AFL with a 3-1 record, drubbed the previously unbeaten Oakland Raiders 27-14. I loved Namath. Who didn't? Statistically, Namath had a bad night, especially after passing for 399 yards and 415 yards in his last two games, I wrote. Against Oakland, he hit only 9 of 29 passes in passing the 4-mile mark, and he was intercepted twice by cornerback Willie Brown. But statistics don't always tell the story. The former Alabama All-American was able to come up with the big play at the right time to get the Jets on the scoreboard. That same month, my father and I got pulled over. I was fined $15 for careless driving and another $15 for failing to sign my driver's permit. My father was found not guilty of a charge of careless driving, as the Herald News dutifully reported. After that, my byline in the paper changed from Herald News staff writer to Herald News sports writer for a couple of days before changing back. But maybe that was just a coincidence. No matter what I was doing in those years, I was always trying to catch as many live sporting events as I could. On July 10, 1968, the Herald News ran an item in Ron Phillips's Sports Whirl on yours truly, informing readers, Jay Horwitz, our former sports associate from Clifton and New York University, recently returned from a Florida vacation. The ex-Herald News sports staffer says that Miami's going crazy over Larry Zonka, the new Dolphins fullback by way of Syracuse University. While in Miami, Jay also took in the dog races, watched the Miami Marlins play in the Florida State Baseball League, and took in a fight at the Miami Beach Auditorium, won by Harold Johnson. In 1969, I was back as a staff writer, and the paper even had me writing a regular column, which ran under various names, Scholastic Sports Scene, Jay Horwitz's Sports Case, but always featured a picture of me right there at the top of the column. I looked dapper in a thin, dark tie and suit, smiling like a guy who can't stop laughing because he can't believe he's really being given the chance to write his own sports column. I did my best to look for ways to repay the trust they put in me when they gave me the column. For an April 1, 1969 column, I opened with a quote from Ralph Waldo Emerson, "Their flag to April's breeze unfurled." That column ran alongside a picture showing me together with Bobby Thompson, famous for the shot heard round the world. Later that month, under a column with the headline, 44-game losing streak today, I opened with a quote from Cervantes's Don Quixote, "Fortune may have yet a better success in reserve for you, and they who lose today may win tomorrow." For a June 11, 1969 column, I opened with a quote from the English poet Alfred Noyes, who had been a rower at Oxford at the turn of the century and later taught in the U.S. at Princeton University, where his students included Edmund Wilson and F. Scott Fitzgerald. I cited a few lines from Noyes' poem, A Victory Dance, his famous anti-war poem first published in the Saturday Evening Post in 1920. God, how the defeated men grin by the wall, watching the fun of the victory ball. That was a lot better than being the millionth sports writer to quote T.S. Eliot. From there, I picked up. The athletes of Clifton High School had plenty of fun this year. The Mustangs captured 4 Passaic Valley Conference titles outright and tied for another to conclude the best overall season in the school's history. At the end of the column, after detailing all the successes of the school's various teams, I raised the question, why does Clifton win? Football coach Bill Vanderkloster, whose team finished a league-leading 8-1, told me, "The town is so sports-oriented that our players know the people are behind them. This helps tremendously." I was still very much a Kennedy liberal at the time, and if I had a chance to write about Camelot, I did. Here was how I opened Jay Horwitz's sports report later in June 1969. 8 years ago, in his inaugural address, the late President John F. Kennedy said, "Ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country." To Bill Horan, who excelled for Queen of Peace High School in New Jersey, in the classroom and on the ball field for the past 4 years, these words still have a deep meaning. Horan will leave June 30th for Annapolis, Maryland to become a plebe at the United States Naval Academy. In words strikingly similar to President Kennedy's message, Bill said, "My country has given me so much. I want to give a little back to my country." I had a chance to go out to Shea Stadium to write about the Mets that July. It was a loss to the Chicago Cubs, snapping a 7-game winning streak. But I had a lot of fun with the piece. "The Mets started the game as if they were going to blow the Cubs right back to the Windy City," I wrote. Gary Gentry retired the first 3 Cubbies in quick order. Leadoff batter Tommy Agee smacked a 3-2 pitch over the right center field fence for his 13th homer and a 1-0 lead. "The game is won," cried one faithful Metnik. I wrote of how Gentry sat disconsolately on a stool in the New York locker room, but the story of the day was Cubs starter Bill Hands. "Met manager Gil Hodges was just as mild-mannered in defeat as he is in victory," I wrote. "Goodness gracious, every time we see Hands, he looks like a 20-game winner. We can't give away runs like we did today against a pitcher of his caliber." I ran from the Mets clubhouse to see what the Cubs were saying on the other side. Meanwhile, back in the winners' quarters, Banks, the Cubs' ageless goodwill ambassador, held court with the press, wearing only his usual jovial smile. Politics was still a huge passion of mine. I'd stuffed envelopes for Robert Kennedy, and when he was killed in L.A. after the California primary in June 1968, it felt to me like a personal loss. I wanted to honor the Kennedy legacy by getting involved. My goal was I wanted to be Frank Mankiewicz, who was Robert Kennedy's press secretary. He was from New York, where he'd grown up the son of a drama critic for the New York Times and the New Yorker, who later wrote the great film Citizen Kane and got into politics because, like me, he was powerfully attracted to the ideals of the Kennedys. In 1969, the Herald News offered me the New York Jets beat, which was an offer I couldn't refuse. I was a diehard New York Giants fan, but the Jets had won the Super Bowl that January, and they were a great story. Here I was, a young kid just finishing his studies, and I was flying all over the country writing about the Jets. The paper made me feel like a star. At the end of July, they ran a big house ad, boxed in a black border, with my picture and the headline, "Direct to you from the 1969 All-Star Game. Your close-up view of the All-Star pregame activity starts today. Herald News sports writer Jay Horwitz reports directly from Chicago's Soldiers Field. You'll get all the fun and flavor, plus exclusive reports on your favorite Jets and Giants on the All-Star roster. Don't miss Jay Horwitz's locker room interviews with key players and coaches." In August, I was in St. Louis for an exhibition game. The Jets mostly played backups, and Joe Namath only played the first half, completing just 6 of 18 passes in a losing effort. At least the Jets coach, Weeb Eubank, kept his sense of humor. "A number of his incomplete passes were right on target," which prompted Eubank to say, "He hit them in the wrong spot, right in the hands," I reported. When the team headed to Southern California to play the San Diego Chargers at the end of September, I was there. Sid Gilman likes his quarterback to be more than a robot, so if sore-armed signal caller John Hadle suffers a relapse against the Jets Sunday, his replacement, rookie Marty Domras, will be practically on his own. Gilman said he looks for his quarterback to be a leader, a man the other players can turn to when the game is in doubt. My dad and I had been talking for years about Gilman, one of the great creative minds in sports, so I was fascinated to get a chance to pick his thoughts. "A guy who has his plays called from the bench can't be that type of person. Gilman told me. Eventually, he's relegated to a handoff man. All I can say is he had better be a hell of a thrower, because that's all he has to offer. What's also going to happen is the guy won't call automatics at the line of scrimmage. He might say, I'll call the original play anyway. It'll be the coach's fault if it fails. I knew my readers would enjoy the contrast with Broadway Joe Namath, who was never going to be at a loss when it came to decision-making on the field. Gilman talked about coaching Namath in an all-star game. Joe came off the field after an unsuccessful drive and told me not to worry, that he could score the next time, he said. That's the type of individual I respect. One thing that stands out, looking back all these years later, is how generous Weeb Eubank was with me, even though I was just out of college and had a lot to learn. I was just a young reporter from a small New Jersey paper, and Weeb and his defensive coordinator Walt Michaels were great to me. The players treated me well, too, and some of them, like linebacker Al Atkinson and center Paul Crane, became close friends and showed me the ropes. Even though I was covering the Jets, my attention was focused on the Miracle Mets. I was thrilled when I had a chance to report on the Mets' National League Championship Series against the Atlanta Braves. After the Mets finished the three-game sweep, I filed a piece focusing on the matchup between Atlanta's Rico Carty and Mets pitcher Nolan Ryan. To Rico Carty, the Atlanta Braves' muscular left fielder, practically all the pitchers he confronts are nameless individuals, I wrote. But as he walked up to engage the Mets' Nolan Ryan in the crucial third inning of yesterday's contest, he was more in the dark than usual. He described himself as a blind man going to bat. Atlanta had a lead and runners on base and was trying to break the game open when Ryan was brought in from the bullpen to face Carty. Standing quietly in the corner of the Braves' dressing room after the Mets had eliminated the Braves from the championship series 7-4, Carty spoke in broken English, I reported. I didn't know what to expect. I asked around trying to find out what he threw, but before I knew it, I was at the plate. Nolan unloaded one pitch, a blazing fastball, which was low and out of the strike zone. Carty swung and missed. He knew now what Ryan threw best. His fastball really hops, moaned Rico. I even worked my love of the Mets into one of my Jets articles. When Cleon Jones snared Dave Johnson's fly ball last Thursday, the Mets became champions of the baseball world, I wrote on October 20, 1969. But that putout also had a deeper significance. It meant the wayward Jets could finally return home. After playing 11 consecutive games on foreign turf this season...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.